Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Well, councillors, this is two or three months ago, council requested the Regional Investment Company to prepare a paper on options for managing the conflict of interest issues that may arise, principally as a result of the fact that the board of the company has three councillors as directors on the board. And in this case, we are using the example, because it's pertinent, of decision-making that lies ahead around the Ruatanava water storage scheme. However, whatever principles or way you proceed to, you determine that you wish to proceed as from today, will apply to any similar activity that may come before the board as well. So while this is about RWS, it's not purely about that. So the board was asked to report back to council by the end of July, and they have prepared a paper which is included as attachment one. And they have gone through and identified, two possible options. One is to accept that the risks are sufficiently low around conflict of interest and predetermination that you decide to do nothing. And the second is that the risks may determine they're sufficiently high that you wish to do something. And from then on, they have then looked at what those options may be. So in regard to that particular paper, council staff have actually asked Stuart Webster from Sainsbury, Logan and Williams to give us some advice around those options, to look at perhaps if there are any other options that may be worth considering as well. And his response to that is attached as attachment two. So if I go back to my actual paper and really just come back to this question of whether or not the risks are high or low, and which will then, I think, you know, may determine what you wish to do. I think if I could summarise it, I would say that in terms of compliance with legislation, the legal requirements and the interpretation of Mr. Webster's advice, is that the risks are low. And he has gone through in his advice, and we have briefly summarised in this paper why that is so. But he's certainly given some very relevant case studies around and around councillor directors on holding companies, for example, in his legal advice. That, I think, is pertinent for both conflict of interest and potential predetermination. So at that point, I'm just going to stop and just because I think that the issue around whether or not it is at low or high risk is not a legal one. It actually comes down to perhaps a political one. So before we move on to that discussion, I'd just like to see if councillors would like to ask Mr. Webster some questions around what he's included in his advice.
Well, perhaps as a preamble, do you have anything you wish to add to that, just as a preamble, and then we'll get into some questions, perhaps?
Chairman, councillors, officers, good morning. As Ms. Lambert said, the genesis of this advice is an issues and options paper that was put up, and my views on this are that do nothing is a viable option for council. And I've supported that with reasons, and I've looked very closely at the Office of the Auditor General in terms of their reports and recommendations, and also for case law. So in coming to that conclusion, I have looked at other ways in which conflicts of interest and predetermination might be managed, and that's either actual or perceived. And I have there on, I think, page 3, set out the prospect that you could manage a perceived or actual conflict of interest by regulating the attendance of a council member at a particular meeting, allowing that council member to attend and not deliberate and not vote, or attend and deliberate and not vote, or allowing that council member to do all three. So I think it's a case of awareness, management of a conflict, rather than a wholesale change in structure. So that's where I got to in my thinking, and I'm happy for that to be tested.
Can I just kick off with a question? HBRIC Limited is a holding company, absolutely, but on the way to this final decision that then council will have to digest and make its decision on...
The RWS.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Thank you. The issue is HBRIC has actually done more than just be a holding company in this instance. We've actually been fingers down into the machinery of our RWS in the void that could have been filled perhaps with a special purpose vehicle mm-hmm. to deliver that mm-hmm. and then come up through a normal holding company process and then to council. Does that particular piece of information alter your view?
Makes no difference at all.
Okay.
And what I've said is that, and this is supported by the Office of the Auditor General, there is a certain logic and sense in having councillors take part and be on the entity that makes that decision or makes that recommendation. In fact, there's an imperative to have that quality of representation, I think, around that table. And I'd say the same for a specialist subsidiary of HBRIC as well that was charged with just doing the RWS. So it makes no difference at all in terms of my advice.
Mr. Chairman, can I just follow your question? Because I actually think, respectfully, that the Office of the General did make a distinction between operating companies and holding companies. And indeed, you quote it quite accurately. I even went back and did the test on it. And it says, we recommend, as in our 94 report, that the boards of holding companies include councillor directors. And you've made a point about they do recommend it. But it then goes on elsewhere in that same document and said, operating companies, however, are different. You don't quote that bit, but it does elsewhere. And that's why I distinguish, because it is a question, Mr. Chairman. Accidentally or otherwise, HBRIC has become an operating company and not a clean holding company just looking after its subsidiaries. And I've got another question on the Companies Act to come the other way on the same issue. Do you have a view now if the Office of the Auditor General did have a distinction?
I suppose in answer to that question, you'd need to put up a specific example of what it is the operating company is doing, which would give rise to a conflict of interest or a suggestion of predetermination. I've read the Auditor General's report as well, and I don't believe that the distinction in the way that is used now with respect makes any difference at all in terms of conflict issues.
Mr. Chairman, if I quote the Office of the Auditor General, another report called Managing Conflicts of Interest Guidance for Public Entities, where the Office of the Auditor General is dealing with a councillor who is a trustee. And it actually says, because a councillor is a trustee and it comes back to council an issue relating to that trust, it actually says the trustee should push their chair back and not vote, although they could be available for information. Mm-hmm. Is that a distinction?
I'd agree with that.
Is there much difference then?
Different obligations owed to the beneficiaries of the trust, and I think what the Auditor General is doing is suggesting a safe course in situations where there may well be a more defined conflict of interest situation arising.
Then let's go the other way. The councillors are directors under the Companies Act. They owe a duty to the company,
mm-hmm.
Section 131, full stop. Mm-hmm. They are not directors of a subsidiary where there can be an open conflict between being a shareholder of the shareholder and sitting on a subsidiary. It's not that situation. They vote in the company for something, whatever it is, forget the issue. They then come here and could vote, according to you, logically, the opposite.
Correct.
How can they balance those two roles?
they can take that hat off and look at it through a different lens. Sorry to mix the metaphor. As a director on a holding company, they can vote in the interests of the company, irrespective of the interests of the stakeholder whom they represent. And that's quite an important distinction. For example, the airport company has that same piece in its constitution, whereby the best interests of the company can sometimes override the best interests of the stakeholders, who are the local authorities and the Crown. So no difficulty at all having a councillor director vote with one set of parameters in the best interest of the company, and then sitting considering the benefits of the region in another entity around the council table. No difficulty.
Mr. Chairman, one last question, and then later I'll enter the debate. The Calvert Dunedin City Council, which I was directly involved in, unfortunately, you indicate in the report, I'm sorry, the first question, did you read the whole case, just a matter of interest?
Yes, I did. In fact, I've got it here.
Yeah, good. Well, we might need it. You mention it as a pecuniary interest. In fact, the debate was about an indirect pecuniary interest, not a pecuniary interest, because it basically said, if you scratch my back, I'll scratch yours. That's what was going on. So councillors who were voting on their director's fees withdrew, and the other companies sat around the table, other directors, and voted for that first company. And that was the argument about the indirect pecuniary interest. Mm. But the judge made two other comments. It says here, the indirect pecuniary interest may involve an interest arising from a relationship and not a specific monetary or contract matter. And the second one is, an indirect pecuniary interest may include a potential benefit or potential liability, and a decision on that situation is assisted by considering the informed objective bystander. And so doesn't that come really at this problem that we're at? It's not necessarily whether there is a direct interest or indirect interest in a pecuniary sense, which you quite rightly said is probably irrelevant in this matter, but whether the informed bystander didn't suggest that the three councillors, in this case, could be two, whatever the number, had a conversation over there, came here, and they agreed to vote in a particular way. I'm not saying they would, but and the judge didn't even say that in the case of Dunedin or Calvert that they did that. He said they might be seen to be doing that. And he struck it down largely on that matter. He also said the motives and good faith of councillors are irrelevant to the issue in front of him. And what I'm really suggesting is it doesn't really matter what the exact fine line is. It actually isn't logical in a public sense. You skirted that in your
Well, the Dunedin City Council case was dealing with director's fees, whether it was direct or indirect pecuniary interest. It's no different to somebody granting themselves a water right. I take the point that it's either money or money's worth that gives rise to that pecuniary interest. I can't see that it's got relevance here because it's making decisions about what is good for the region.
One last question, then I will shut up at this moment. Can I ask a question? If I hypothetically moved right now to remove the three directors, councillor directors, can they vote?
Are you saying a council resolution to remove them from HBRIC?
Yes. Can they vote, given their reputation could be damaged?
I think the answer to that would be it would be advisable for them to abstain from voting, but whether they take part, whether they sit in the meeting, whether they deliberate is another issue. But probably voting on that issue might give rise to a conflict of interest, yes.
Just so I'm clear on that, you're talking about if there was a resolution put at the end of this paper to remove councillors, that's your understanding of that?
That's how the question was
put. Thank you. I'm just trying to test the continuum in here. As you can appreciate, Mr. Webster and I probably disagree on this, and I respect his opinion. But I'd have to say, and I know this is not a debating point, but it's just a comment relating to it. We had two very clear legal opinions in Dunedin, both of which said we were doing exactly the right thing, and it still lost.
Councillor Dick.